As we all know, Dr. Sam Pitroda needs no introduction. All the mobile phone and the internet that you're using is all courtesy Dr. Sam Pitroda. He has over 100 patents to his name, and despite his humble background, he did not hesitate to take the world over. Many of you may not know that he is an educationist at heart. He is very, very passionate about the student community and thinks that the outmoded education system of India especially needs to be revisited. Sir, today we have a house full of the Generation Y here. But as facilitators to education, there's one question that haunts our minds. Where is this generation heading? All of us have this question, don't we, as facilitators to education? The kind of competitive and fast-paced life our students lead leave them detached and distressed. Thus, we are on our way to decipher whether the Gandhian principles will be rationally acceptable to a generation that has gone digital by all means. And who better than the technocrat Dr. Sam Pitroda to give us a holistic view on the Gandhian principle. Today, without much ado, I would like to leave the stage to Dr. Sam Pitroda to throw light on the subject the house has chosen. Is Mahatma Gandhi still relevant? May I request, sir, to please take the stage.
Sorry about that. Dear students, members of the Bhawanipur Education Society, my friend Dinesh Trivedi, Narari Bhai, and other colleagues with whom I had an opportunity to have dinner last night. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is indeed a very special privilege for me to be here in this great city with large number of my Gujarati community friends. I am thankful to them for giving me this opportunity, and I am delighted that you have been able to bring together large number of young people to talk a little bit about Gandhiji. What do our young really look forward to is a question in the minds of many in this country. We always talk about the fact that we have 550 million young below age of 25. What do we do for them? How do we give them nutrition, food, skills, education, employment, opportunities, dream, and prosperity has to be the core of Indian thought. Without really thinking of our young, we cannot think of India's future. To me, this is the workforce for the world. Everywhere else, population is aging and decreasing, while in India, population is young and increasing. We talk about demographic dividends. But to get those dividends, we need to really spend a lot of time thinking about how do we build their future? What do we do with them? And that's where I believe Gandhi comes in. To me, Gandhiji is more relevant today than ever before in the history of India. Not only for India, but for the rest of the world. As the world is going through quite a bit of crisis, as this world is in the state of flux, world is looking for a new model of development. What does Gandhi mean to people today? It's something we are going to talk a little bit about. I was born and raised in a small little tribal village in Orissa of Gujarati parents, born in 1942. In those days, there was still independence movement going on, and Gandhi and Sardar Patel were very much part of the Gujarati family conversation. Everywhere you met in the family, people talked about Gandhiji and Sardar Patel and Nehru and others. My first memory of Gandhiji is still very clear to me in my mind. I was sitting outside with my younger brother playing, and my father came in and said, "Gandhiji, Bapu has been shot dead." Immediately my mother started saying Ram Ram, and we all had to take a bath. As a little boy, I still remember that. In a sense, we had this connection with Gandhiji, which was like he was part of your family. Gandhian thought was very much part of growing up. Then I had no idea that I'll wind up working on technology, going to America, thinking about telecom and computers and software. Then the thought was very much about charkha. Then the thought was very much about khadi. India got independence in 47. We were all still very young. And a lot of us didn't know the meaning of it. But I know that it meant a lot to my father, who had fourth grade education, came from Gujarat looking for work to Orissa. And when he tried to sell nails during war to British, he couldn't speak English. And he told me a story that he went to sell this nail, box of nail, and he couldn't communicate. He just didn't know what to tell this fellow. And he felt humiliated. Then he realized that the most important thing in his life is going to be education. He must make sure that all of his kids go to college and study well and build Gandhian character. Follow Sardar Patel's track. We are 8 brothers and sisters. All went to college except one. All went to America, settled there. And this journey, in spite of the fact, took us far away from India, always kept Gandhian thought as the core of living. So Gandhi means many things to many people. Gandhi is more relevant today to young and old, urban, rural, educated, uneducated, rich and poor. Gandhi is all about ideas. It's about non-violence. It's about disparity. It's about greed, hypocrisy, and fight against it. It is about simplicity. In this world full of conflicts, violence, in this world full of fights of all kinds, Gandhian approach to life makes a lot of sense, but it's very difficult to follow. Gandhi was a father of a nation. He was a leader. In a sense, he was a fakir. He stood for some basic principles like truth, non-violence, concern for others, concern for minority. All of these things that we have seen, we have read, today somehow are on the back burner. Take for example truth. What a simple idea, that if everybody spoke facts, if you tell people what you mean and if you mean what you tell, you won't need so many lawyers in the world. You know, America with 5% of the population has 50% of the lawyers in the world. Why? Because nobody trusts anybody else. Every time you do a deal of any kind, whether you buy something, sell something, agree on some contract, you have a whole group of lawyers drafting pages and pages of contract. Because there is no trust. People know that you don't mean what you say and you don't say what you mean. Gandhi had this whole idea of public virtue and personal values. I remember when WikiLeaks came out a couple of years ago. In US there was a lot of backlashes. US government wanted to get after this WikiLeaks. Everyone was really mad, mainly because what they said in private was exactly opposite to what they said in public. If you had said same thing, you wouldn't worry about it. Government was really mad because they realized that WikiLeaks really exposed the real fact. They didn't mean what they said, and they didn't say what they mean. Gandhi was just about so clear on some of these things. The most impressive part of Gandhi for me is his self-esteem. In my dealings in India, I find that almost everyone has very fragile self-esteem. Everybody is ready to be hurt. You don't say hello to me and you say hello to Dinesh Bhai, I will not talk to you for 3 days. You don't invite me to your party, I would believe that you don't like me anymore. All of this really comes from the fact that we are not comfortable with ourselves. For me to like you, I must like myself. If I don't like myself, I will always find faults in you. And I find very large number of people at all levels are very uncomfortable with their own self. I see this in big political meetings in Delhi. I see it in scientific communities. I see it in business. And we are also very hierarchical and feudal. I remember in early days in 80s going to government meetings, and there are 30, 40 people in a meeting, and when the tea is served, you know, you will find out who works for whom. Everybody is waiting for the boss, head of the department, to start drinking his tea. When he starts drinking, 3 other people start, so you know that these 3 work for him. It is that level of hierarchy. And it is that level of self-confidence we have. Gandhiji was full of self-confidence. He could talk to Viceroy, he could talk to police, and he could talk to peon. Didn't make any difference. He really understood clearly the meaning of 4 words, which I believe define Indian society. Man, Apman, Abhiman, and Swaman. These are important words in India. When I look at Ramayana and Mahabharata, it's all about these four words. It's all about man, apman, abhiman, swaman. We are so caught up in getting reference point from somebody else. We are always worried about how would you feel, not about how I would feel. What would you say, not about what is right to do. And I think somehow we have lost track of a lot of these things from Gandhi. To me, he was a great communicator, ever lived. How could you just pick up a pinch of salt and galvanize the entire nation? Who would think of an idea like that? That I go pick up salt and the whole world will notice it. Especially in an era when there was very little television, almost none, very little radio. But he had that ability to create symbols for communication. His prayer, his charkha, his goat milk, all of these things represented his ways to communicate. His life was his message. Not that he couldn't find enough clothing, but he wanted to emphasize that he is with poor. And you look at him and you get complete picture of the man. He wasn't fat. He wore very little clothing. You know, issues with haircut. All of these things were designed consciously or unconsciously to reflect the man he was inside. He also had a lot of courage. His dreams were very big. His idea was to free this world from colonial masters. I mean, what a dream. Bigger the job, bigger the leader. His mission in life was not just to get freedom for India, but also to get freedom everywhere from British Raj. One man, Gujarati man, who believed in the song you heard, whose prayers were very simple, but he could really shake the system which was established for 150, 200 years. And he had no other power except moral authority. He had no tools to fight, but his inner strength. What started in India in terms of decolonization created a series of movements in Africa and other parts of the world. And quickly, billions got freedom from all kinds of colonial past. Gandhi was an innovator. He invented the experiment with truth. He was not afraid to fail. He worried about bottom of the economic pyramid. He could mobilize a lot of resources and he could solve big problems, but he believed in discipline, perseverance, determination. And these are not just words. It's not something you just spell out to somebody. It is something you live with. And when I talk to young people, I always emphasize the fact, in college, you don't learn math or science or physics or history or political science or economics. You really learn discipline. You learn ability to analyze. You learn to be creative. You learn to be respectful of different people's opinion. You learn to be ethical. You learn to be global. You learn to be multidisciplinary. But somehow we are never told these things in colleges. That is not about passing an exam or getting a grade or making A and going to a next class. It is all about learning these fundamental skills that Gandhiji not only talked about, but practiced in a very interesting way. When we think of Gandhi, we never think this way. In India, we have taken Gandhi and put it on a pedestal, put some garland once in a while, go look up, then look down and do what you are doing. Lie, cheat, don't pay your tax, fight with people, be jealous of everybody. That's not what Gandhi meant. And especially in India, two Indians, Gandhi should have meant a lot more. It is unfortunate that a leader like this is somehow unnoticed. You go see what happens in Indian Parliament. You go see the leadership in India. And you wonder whether Gandhi ever lived here. I don't understand why Gandhi is still not fresh in the minds of people in this country. Gandhi is a way of life. It's not a character. I must tell you, about 20 years ago, I was in Calcutta and I gave a convocation speech at IIM in Calcutta. And like this, there was a big crowd of young people graduating. And normally I don't prepare my speeches, I just talk based on whatever I feel like, because that allows me to speak my mind. If I write things down, I mess it up because I have to read and somebody else writes it for me. So in my mood, I talked about Gandhiji then to these young people. And I said, to me, you could be drinking scotch, wearing jeans and still be Gandhian. Next day in Telegraph, there was a headline, Pitroda said, Gandhi drank scotch and wore jeans. Then all the Gandhians got together and said, Pitroda must apologize. So they wrote a letter to Prime Minister. I got a call from Prime Minister's office then, and I said, I'm not apologizing. Because I still believe that. You don't have to agree with it. That's your privilege. But I believe that for you to be Gandhian in your own way, it's okay for you to drink scotch. You don't have to take Gandhi in totality. That wasn't enough. So they all got together and wrote a letter to President of India. I got a call from President of India. I said, I'm not apologizing. The point is, we get so hung up on our version of Gandhi that we want to project in public sphere as opposed to live it in private life. Gandhi is all about living it in your own way, in your own life, and not advise people about Gandhi or how they should live. In 21st century, leadership is going to be very different than the leadership of the 20th century. Leadership of the 20th century was based more on command and control. We have just come out of 20th century with still world war in the back of our mind. Everything is about war engines. Everything is about restructuring your economy. In the 21st century, web, internet is changing everything. I don't think we understand the impact of web. To me, web is a bigger disruptive force than World War II. In World War II, you could see the destruction. Building torn apart, bombs all over, people dying. But with web, everything is changing. Business models are changing, products are changing, delivery of services change, government services will change, financial services change, and we just don't know how it will affect us. Education will change. This morning when I gave a convocation speech at the Presidency University, I said, I don't need teacher to create content and deliver content. If the content is already on the web, I can get it any way I want. What do I need teacher for? Maybe I need teacher as a mentor. But then today teachers are not trained to be mentors. So you have this old method of teaching: duster, blackboard, chalk, textbook, exam, grade, certificate. None of these things matter anymore. So in 21st century, internet brings about openness, accessibility, connectivity, networking, democratization, decentralization. And leadership will have to be in tune with all of these tools. Unfortunately, our leaders don't quite understand the impact of a lot of these things. When I think of Gandhiji, I also think of Ram Rajya that he talked about. His dream of rural development, his dream of doing things locally. Somehow Gandhiji's dream for Ram Rajya could not be translated into reality in 40s and 50s, mainly because we didn't have the tools. Today with internet, it is possible to translate Gandhiji's dream of Ram Rajya and rural development, because now you have all the tools to bring best of the best know-how into villages. As part of this government's program, we introduce right to information. To me, it is a very Gandhian idea. Saying it is my right to know, as citizen, where you are spending money, what you are doing, who is doing what. We never had right to information before. Now that we have right to information, a lot of people panic. Lots of people ask for information. But we don't have information, because information is locked up in our Nadawali file. And that Nadawali file only few people can play with. So part of the program that we have underway is to really democratize information. The idea is to take optical fiber to all panchayats, 250,000. When optical fiber goes to all panchayats, which will require about 500,000 kilometers of additional fiber on top of the million kilometer we already have, then you will have huge amount of data available on all kinds of things. We have just developed open government platform on which you can submit a lot of government data on infant mortality, female literacy, water, energy, education, health, planning. And this data is then available to citizens, especially young people. Then they can play with this data, develop applications. Look at a district and see what's happening in this district, what's happening in this panchayat. How much money was spent, where did it go, who worked on what project, what got finished, what didn't get finished. All of these things will expose people, and that's very Gandhian. All of these things will bring facts in public domain. Truth will prevail, and a lot of people are scared of these tools, believe me. When we started open data platform, for 6 months, none of the government departments would open their data. I spoke to PM's office, I spoke to cabinet secretary, spoke to ministers, everybody said, great idea. Met with Montek Aluwalia, saying planning data is not planning commission's data, it is people's data. Open it up. They say, yes, it's a good idea, but we need a committee to decide on what data to open, because we need to sanitize our data. We fought and fought for 8 months, and finally, government now has 3,700 data sets available on internet. Our goal is to make 10,000 data sets available. But it is unfortunate that a lot of our young don't even know about it. Maybe we don't talk enough about it. But this is the process that we are following to really back up the right to information. This is something where all of the modern tools will help us in opening our systems. A lot of Gandhian stuff came from the heart and not from the mind. Gandhian thought has a lot to do with heart than with mind. It is not about numbers and graphs and charts. It's about what is good for the people in general. What can we do to lift 500, 400 million people below poverty line to respectable standard of living? How do we give dignity to labor? Everything that he did 50 years ago, 60 years ago, is so very relevant today. How do we put that in modern framework? How do we excite our young to live Gandhian way of life? Not necessarily go take charkha and wear dhoti, but follow the path of truth and absolute truth, simplicity, sacrifice, concern for humanity, concern for minority, unconditional love for everybody. These are very simple things to do. The question is, can you do it? Can you build a life where there is no jealousy? That you are not jealous about anything. You don't have enemy in life. You love your own enemy. You don't compare yourselves to anybody. You don't need to be good or bad. You need to be yourself. I think this is what Gandhiji would have liked all of us to be. I believe Gujaratis have bigger moral responsibility to carry on Gandhian dream, because somehow it comes natural to many of us. Whenever I listen to Vaishnavajan to Tenere Kahiye, I realize what an interesting idea. In one song, you have really put in every thought that every human being should follow. Just one little song tells it all. Can you just follow that? If you follow that, what kind of a world we would create? This brings me to the global scenario. On one hand, India is at crossroads. On the other hand, world is at crossroads also. Because right after World War II, US decided to dominate this world by setting up global institutions like UN, World Bank, IMF, NATO, WIPO, and everything else. This allowed US to dominate bipolar world, keep US dollar as the premier currency, and at that time, handful of 300 million people could hog a lot of the world resources. So US turned out to be 25 times richer than many of the emerging markets. That was okay for a long time until communication opened the horizon. When television was introduced in Germany, people could see in the East Germany what was happening in the West Germany. The physical wall had no meaning anymore because you could penetrate through the wall and see exactly the lifestyle in the Western Germany. And everybody in East Germany said, I want that. Coupled with telecom, with 7 billion mobile phones, today you have large number of people with similar aspirations. Then world was still colonized after World War. One by one, world got decolonized, and you got 3 billion more people with same aspirations. 1 billion from India, billion from China, billion from former Soviet Union. So when you have 3 billion more wanting the same model of development, it is just not feasible. So the American model of development based on consumption is not scalable, sustainable, workable, desirable. Can you imagine if India had 1.2 billion cars? What will happen to this planet? If China had 1.3 billion cars, what will happen to the environment? So we need to find, world needs to find a new model of development. World is searching for this. There is crisis here, there is crisis there, because this model is beginning to collapse. You cannot create enough jobs just by producing goods and services for richer countries. Indians also want goods and services. We need local production, local capabilities, local requirements. Same with China, same with other parts of the world. This is where you go back, according to me, to Gandhian thought. You need to find answers in Gandhian way of doing things. It means don't focus on conspicuous consumption. There is a limit to what you consume. Gandhi used to say about needs and wants. And I think there is a lot of truth. To live simple life, to understand human needs, to focus on inclusive development, to make sure that the poor also get the benefit of development with you. In India, when we talk of inclusive growth, that is what we are talking about. It is Gandhian thought. In America, there is very little conversation on inclusive growth. So rich gets richer and poor remain poor. And that creates tension. So I believe today, Gandhi is much more relevant to young, to Western world, to India and Indians and leaders and businessmen and ordinary people. Gandhi was all about democracy, development, inclusive growth, but in a very different way. And I think we have lost touch with Gandhian way of doing things. I remember Gandhi being in Calcutta, reading about it. Recently, I read his conversation with Tagore. We all have read a great deal. And about 3 years ago, I decided to work with Gandhi Ashram in Ahmedabad to launch 4 projects. One, to create Gandhi portal, which we are going to launch on 2nd of September with Prime Minister and Mrs. Sonia Gandhi and everybody. The idea was to create a portal where all Gandhian information is available in one place. Photographs, articles, you know, songs, everything, all books. Then we are creating Gandhian heritage sites. Gandhiji visited about 2,000 sites in India. We are taking 20, 30, 40 sites and building those sites. Ultimately, we would like to build 200 of these sites. Then we want to really focus on taking Gujarat Vidyapit, which is all about Gandhian teaching, to the rest of the country and perhaps the rest of the world. Today, Gujarat Vidyapit teaches Gandhian thought only in Gujarati. So I met with people there, Vice Chancellor Sudarshan Bhai, and I said, Sudarshan Bhai, we need to really take this national. So we are now putting this stuff in video format, putting it on knowledge network, and there should be Gandhi studies in Calcutta, in Tamil Nadu, in Kerala, everywhere else. Why not? Then we want to create a once a year conference on Gandhi's intellectual heritage. When we prepare this portal, we want to translate in Japanese, Russian, French, Portuguese, because Gandhi is relevant not only to our young, but also to the young in the world. This is a long journey. I believe our young need to pay a lot more attention to Gandhian thought. Unfortunately, all we see on Indian television is cricket, Bollywood, and gossip. I worry when I see Indian television, which I hardly see. I worry when I talk to our younger generation, because they wind up talking like their parents. I worry when we begin to copy Western world in everything we do. I worry when we don't think of Gandhi in our daily thought. I worry when we don't think of people at the bottom of the pyramid. 2 days ago, I was in Tamil Nadu at the place where Rajiv Gandhi died. And I spoke to about 1,000 students. And one student came during question answer and complained. He said, sir, why don't we have discipline? Why do people throw garbage all over? Why do I have to tell people that don't throw garbage and they never listen to me? I said, look, if I was in your position, I would do one thing. First, don't worry about changing everybody. Change yourself. So if somebody is spitting and if you are too concerned, don't tell him not to spit. But quietly take your handkerchief, wipe his spit, put it in your pocket and walk out. I said, that's what Gandhiji would have done. He wouldn't have given him a lecture. Keep doing that for maybe a year and people will begin to get the message. In India, everybody thinks problem is there. Problem is never here. Everybody is quick to identify problems. This is wrong, that is wrong, this is not working, that is not working. And I tell my friends, you do not need talent in India to identify problems. So don't think you have come up with some great idea by identifying a problem. You probably don't need talent also to find solutions. You need real courage, commitment, passion to go get it done against all the odds. And that's what Gandhiji wants all of us to do. So I would encourage my young colleagues here to go read a little bit about Gandhi. Go Google Gandhiji. See Gandhi movie again and again, 2-3 times. Learn, internalize, and realize that you are indeed living in best of the best times in the world. You have great technology, you have wonderful heritage in India, our history, our culture, and our Gandhi gives you the roadmap. When in trouble, think of Gandhi and everything else would seem so trivial. With this, I want to thank Dinesh Bhai and others for giving me this opportunity. Really want to appreciate your coming and listening so quietly. Thank you. You want to come here?
No,
sir. To be here?
Absolutely.
Huh?
Absolutely. You can have a seat, sir. So wish.
I believe Dinesh Bhai is coming here.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Okay.
It's my label, sir. Okay. So be the change you wish to see. Thank you so much, sir, for that enriching discourse. We have with us today Mrs. Pitroda and Srimati Dinesh Trivedi. May I please request our president to please felicitate Mrs. Pitroda. And Mrs. Doshi to please felicitate Mrs. Trivedi. Take the opportunity to invite our guest of honor, Sri Dinesh Trivedi, who too needs no introduction in the state of Bengal. He is a favorite with the student fraternity for his fervor and uprightness. We are proud to have you with us, sir. May I request Sri Dinesh Trivedi to please have a conversation with Dr. Pitroda and then open the floor for an interactive session that our students are waiting for. And also the college has decided to award the best question that will be judged by Dr. Pitroda and the prize too will be handed over by him. Thank you.
First of all, my apology, I didn't realize I took much longer than I thought. I just looked at the watch. My apology. Just went on probably for too long.
So you want a label or?
Which is whatever.
You want a, I'll give you a label, sir.
Hello, hello, hello.
Just switch it on.
Do I get one?
Can you hear me? Hello, hi, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, they can hear me.
Somebody want me to stand there?
No. No, they are giving you. Do you have a label here? Okay, while Sam is getting ready with his personal microphone, let me thank Miraj Bhai, Mr. Doshi, Mr. Seth, and the entire Bhawanipur Education Society College for putting up this great and wonderful show. I am thoroughly impressed. I mean, Sam, you can see the energy out there.
Thank you.
And this is the energy which I truly feel is going to change.
Thank you. Miraj, I want one t-shirt. Huh?
And make sure the photograph is mine and yours. Sam, what we are going to do in the next, we have got about 25 to 30 minutes, which can be perhaps extended by maybe 5-7 minutes. What we are going to do out here is maybe we'll have a little chit-chat with Sam and then throw the floor open for some questions on the subject. You know, typically in Bengal we call it adda. And that's what we are going to have. Unfortunately, we don't have the Moody and Taylor adda. Perhaps Miraj can organize some tea. But the problem is we alone can't have it. Adda is not adda unless everybody participates. Sir, that was really a wonderful insight to Mahatma Gandhi. It's very important to put the word Mahatma. And you know why. Everywhere in the world when you go, and I have lived in America, you have lived most of your life, India means Gandhi, and you had world leaders like Martin Luther King, you had Nelson Mandela, Aung San Suu Kyi. They are all on the models of Gandhi. Now for me sitting here and even ask questions related to Gandhiji, it's not easy. It's like, you know, studying Upanishad or Gita or any spiritual book of knowledge, Guru Granth Sahib or Quran Sharif or whatever. Because in order to know Gandhi and ask about Gandhi, you really have to do a lot of research. Because very honestly, like you rightly said, Gandhi means different things to different people depending on how you interpret. But let me ask you first, Sam, that while world has created so many models of Gandhi in terms of world leaders, it reminds me of a scene, like, you know, we are in a big mela. And we have seen in Hindi movies, ki mele mein jab rehte hain, to koi apne bichhad jaate. And we have lost somebody who's precious. Sometimes I feel when I look back, where did we lose Gandhi? Because it's very certain that somewhere down the line, we have lost him. Is there symbolically very much? Is there in your thought and my thought? But somewhere there is a disconnect. Where do you think, Sam, we have lost Gandhi?
First of all, I am not really expert on Gandhi. I'm just a regular engineer. So you really need to ask somebody who knows Gandhi and has studied Gandhi deeply. My knowledge is sort of, you know, on the surface, really. I have internalized Gandhi in my own way, based on few major sort of words that I thought would define Gandhi for me. Having said that, if I was to answer this, I would venture into saying that we have gotten, after material life, too quickly. Everybody wants quick success. Everybody wants to make a lot of money quickly, dishonestly. Everybody wants to cheat, not pay tax. Everybody is after money because people value money. You know, Forbes publishes list of 400 richest people. They don't publish list of 400 best doctors, 400 best teachers, 400 best human beings. World over, people worship rich. People don't worship people with good character. Sometimes people with good characters are lying in jail. So I think we have created this world where money is seen as the sign of success, prosperity, respect, you know. So everybody is after money. And in the process, Gandhi is something you have it at home, put little garland, look at him once in a while, and then go do your thing. That's what happened, I think.